What's going on, you guys? It's yours truly, the real Sakurai, and welcome to Deadpool Week. And this one, we're going to start out with, of course, I mentioned in the last video, ComicsExplained, featuring the Return of the X-Force, X-Men, Messiah Complex Part 4. Now, I don't know if we're going to be doing, you know, the other Messiah Complexes, which most likely we will, because I love hearing from this guy. I love hearing from ComicsExplained all the time. So, yeah, this is going to be about that video. So, without further ado, have a look at this.
What's going on, guys? This is Rob. If you guys enjoy my content, make sure you hit the subscribe button and make sure you hit that little bell so you never miss out on my sexy voice. Okay, so picking back up with Messiah Complex, again, this is one of the coolest stories when it comes to the whole X-Men concept, because remember, this is the baby, like this is this little kid, the first child born after the events of House of M, when the Scarlet Witch took everybody's powers away, took like 98% of the mutant population's powers away. It's been a whole mad race. That's all this is. This is like a massive mad race to find this kid. On one side, you got Mr. Sinister, this mutant geneticist, you've got the Purifiers, and then you've got the X-Men trying to find them. But the other thing that this did is it saw the return of Cable. That's what we talked about in the last video. The Cable's basically back, and the Cable has this baby. Now, this is a very important thing, because the future of the mutant race hinges on this kid. That's how it's perceived. What is this baby capable of? Is it possible that it's got some sort of a genome that can either be used, modified, or what have you, that can just start bolstering people's powers? That's the big question people have, because remember, in the X-Men landscape, you've got mutants like Leech that has the ability to shut off people's powers. Well, what if this baby's the opposite? It has the ability to turn powers on. And so that's the question that the X-Men are asking. That's what they're trying to figure out here. And so, of course, with them basically tracking down different forces along the way, the Purifiers, the Marauders, so on and so forth, they have for the most part been pretty wrecked. But making their return back to the Xavier Institute, the problem they're facing here is the Xavier Institute itself is under attack, just because of the fact that the human pilots of these Sentinels are now basically just, you know, going awry and attacking everyone. Now, for those of you guys who are catching up here, following the events of House of M, what you had is you had something called the Office of National Emergency, O1E, and that was O-N-E, and that was basically like jump-started by the federal government. Now, the idea was that the Sentinels were, in the past in Marvel Comics, they've been autonomous, meaning that they don't really have human pilots, and instead, they function according to whatever programming they have. In this, the humans control the Sentinels. Like, they're literally pilots inside the Sentinels, moving them around. But the pilots have essentially been taken over by a kind of nanovirus that was exposed to them by Cassandra Nova. Now, Cassandra Nova is someone that we haven't really talked about before, and if you're new to comics, you probably don't really know anything about her. I mean, she's very much a foreign name to you. Cassandra Nova was a character created by Grant Morrison, and the idea was that he created her as a means to show, like, you know, negativity and evil, and so, you know, yada yada yada, all that Grant Morrison stuff. Inside of comic books, she's like a magistrati, I think is what it is, but the idea was originally she was just like the unborn twin of Xavier, basically, and he had like destroyed her in the womb. And the reason why was because Xavier had realized how evil she was, that she was going to be, you know, this terrible thing. It was a really weird situation, but the biggest claim to fame to Cassandra Nova is that she had basically reinstated these things called wild Sentinels, which is to say Sentinels that literally existed in the wild. They were kind of created out there and had whatever programming any one particular person wanted to give them, so long as they were part of the Bolivar Trask gene, which is to say the genealogy of the man who invented the Sentinels. And so as a result, what ended up happening is she basically sent these wild Sentinels to Genosha, which was an island where mutants could exist. They could live without concern about mutant oppressors or anything like that. And she had the Sentinels massacre 16 million mutants. It was insane. But she's always been one of those characters who, depending on who's writing the story, sometimes she's kind of an ally of the X-Men. More often than not, she's an enemy. And so the result of this is that these Sentinels being taken over, or I guess these pilots being taken over by a kind of virus, allows Cassandra Nova to go through and literally start attacking the X-Men. Now, there is a lot going on with this, and there is something bigger happening behind the scenes, and we'll find out at the end of this video. But something else to also notice here is that all the telepaths have basically been knocked out, and that was done for a reason. It was done explicitly so that nobody would realize what it is that's actually going on here. In response, response to this, you so that nobody would realize what it is that's actually going on here. In response to this, you also have like X-23, Laura Kinney, her forces showing back up at the Xavier Institute. You've got the field group of the X-Men, Wolverine, and those guys who are coming back from their mission. And so they're all kind of descending back onto the Institute at the time that everything's going awry. So it's really just kind of a gathering of the X-Men to, you know, eliminate these Sentinels and get rid of them. Now, of course, one of them does show up, and that's when you basically learn they've been taken over by this virus of sorts. But of course, that version's basically defeated, and another one gets away, and that's really about it. But following this, there's this really, really cool conversation that ends up happening between Wolverine and Cyclops. And this is really, really awesome, because what happens is Cyclops basically sits down and says, okay, the gloves need to come off. We've been trying to do this peaceful coexistence thing, and it's not working for us. We've got the purifiers after us. We've got the marauders after us. We're literally being hit from every side. It's time to start playing hardball again. And the reason why this matters is for a couple things. The first is because this begins, or really starts to see this sort of gradual decline of Cyclops becoming a villain, in the sense that he starts to become more and more extreme. And that's one of the things that it really took about 10 years to make that happen. The idea of Cyclops kind of becoming more and more extreme, almost becoming Magneto-esque in terms of how he dealt with various confrontations, that took a long time, leading up to, 2014, really 2012, when it really started to pop off. But the other reason why this matters is because...
That's why I like this Cyclops, because I knew he's about his shit. Everybody likes to dog Cyclops because of the fact that all he had was his laser beam power that he couldn't control that because he could only make sure it was shielding and all that, but ComicsExplained is right. It took him a long time to be about this, so I'm glad that finally we get to see this.
Really 2012, when it really started to pop off. But the other reason why this matters is because Cyclops says, if we're going to go after Cable, because he's the one that has the kid, this is Cable that we're talking about. And that's one thing to bear in mind. There's a really cool story called Avengers X-Sanction, where Cable takes on the Avengers and the X-Men and beats them all. And so when you're talking about someone like that, he's very, very capable. He's got futuristic technology. He's a master when it comes to military strategy. He's a master tactician. He's a very, very capable guy. And so it's not like you just send Wolverine in to just pummel Cable and then take the baby and leave. Like, Cable will pull out every stop in order to achieve whatever his goal happens to be. And that's when Cyclops responds by saying, we can't just send anyone in to do this. What we need is the group. Like, we need a strike force team. And that's when we end up seeing the return of X-Force. Now, we'll probably do a video explaining X-Force once we get closer to the release of Deadpool 2. But the long and short of this is that originally X-Force was really the New Mutants. Like, the New Mutants were introduced by Marvel in a storyline where it was believed the X-Men had died at the hands of the Brood. And so the New Mutants were kind of like the new generation of mutants. The original X-Men eventually came back, and the New Mutants were kind of free-floating for a while. And then when Rob Liefeld took over the New Mutants line of comics, he started with issue number 86, introduced Cable in issue number 87, and from that issue going forward to issue number 100, he started molding the New Mutants into an actual Strike Force team that was led by Cable, hence the reason why New Mutants cancels at issue number 100, X-Force number 1 picks up, and it's a seamless transition. And so with that going forward, like from that point going into the future of Marvel Comics, because X-Force was so popular, Marvel always kept it the same. It was always a Strike Force team. But of course, what ends up happening here is you basically end up having Cable, who comes across the forces of Lady Deathstrike. Not too big, just kind of a small little thing. Some stuff happens, whatever. You know, and he basically manages to hold his own against him, as we would expect. I mean, it's Lady Deathstrike. She's got, some really sharp fingers, and, she's really good at fighting, but there's really nothing that special about her. One thing to focus, though, and this is kind of an aside thing, at least at this point in the story, it's kind of a background thing. The whole idea of Jimmy Madrox and Layla Miller. Remember, when it came to them working alongside this, they were basically sent to Forge. Basically, this mutant, this like Tony Stark, but the knowledge he possesses is a byproduct of the power that he has. His ability to reverse engineer technology, to know how things work, that's his actual mutant power. The idea is that he basically created a kind of interdimensional time machine that would give Layla Miller and Jimmy Madrox, Multiple Man, the ability to jump into like two different alternate universes to find out why everybody's seeking after this baby, what it is that's going on on here. And so they ended up jumping into another, into a different reality 80 years in the future. And it's basically like Days of Future Past is really what it is. There's mutant concentration camps. You know, mutants are basically thrown into these camps. We don't know what it was, the catalyst that led to this universe being the way it is. But the fact that it's here and the very nature of their actions indicates that it has something to do with this baby. And now we actually know what's going on, but for the sake of, like, you know, remaining in the moment, I don't want to spoil it at all because it is kind of cool. But the other part of this is that you basically end up picking up with Wolverine and his forces, basically X-Force, intercepting Cable in his fight with Lady Deathstrike. Now, this is pretty awesome because for the most part, I mean, like X-23 and these guys, they're able to face off against these forces, and that's why this isn't like a major thing. The big takeaway from this, and this is one of the reasons why I love Cable so much, is Wolverine, among everyone here, Wolverine's the only one who really knows the threat that Cable poses, because Wolverine's been there ever since Cable first popped up. And that's why this entire time he's basically been telling X-Force, do not underestimate Cable. Now, of course, Wolverine and these guys locating Cable, that's because of the fact that, like, the Stepford Cuckoos and everybody basically recovered, and they use, you know, of course, Cerebro to locate where it is that Cable was at. But again, the cool thing about this is that what Cable ends up doing is basically doubling back. And that's one of the funny things about this, is because in any normal circumstance, Wolverine would have realized what was going on, right? Like, he would have been chasing Cable down and would have said, well, I've already been here before. But being so caught up in the moment chasing after Cable, X-Force, and Wolverine dealing with the forces of Lady Deathstrike, it's enough to throw anybody off, regardless of how honed their skills are. And so when Wolverine ends up doubling back, he finally realizes what's going on, asks the question as to why, and we find out that Cable actually jacked the Blackbird of Wolverine. He literally hijacked the ship and took off. And it's so cool, and it's such a smart thing to do. It's really one of the more interesting things about his character. But that's the whole nature behind this. That's the important thing to walk away from with this, is just how capable Cable is, and just how dangerous he truly can be. And so what we end up doing is fast forwarding and picking up with Cable when he shows up in Dallas, Texas, heading to Eagle Plaza. And the reason why is because this is where Forge is located. Now, Cable showing up here is basically saying, look, I've got this baby. I need to be able to time travel. I need your time travel device. Now, this would buy Cable time. What would end up happening most likely is Cable would basically jump forward to his own timeline and then reassemble a new time travel device, and that would give him the ability to start jumping around again. But showing up here, what he ends up finding out is that Forge has basically been taken out. And that's the mystery, is who was it that took out Forge? And so what we end up doing is picking up with Cable being knocked out, and we end up finding out the person who orchestrated all this is actually Bishop. That Bishop was the one who incapacitated the telepath. Bishop was the one who set the virus free on the Sentinels as a distraction to keep the X-Men preoccupied so they wouldn't realize what it was that he was doing. Bishop is the one who traveled to Forge's house, and Bishop is the one who shot him. And that's the question. Why is Bishop doing all of this? But with that being said, guys, we're going to bring this video to an end. If you are new here to Comics Explained, make sure you guys hit the sub button to become part of the Rob Corps. If you guys enjoyed this video, make sure you drop a like, and I will catch you all
later. That's crazy. That's honestly, that makes me want to watch more from Comics Explained now. Holy shit, dude. Holy crap. Oh, that makes me want to look at even more. That's going on with that comic. Jesus Christ. Also, I want to point this out. I didn't know much about Cable. I didn't know much about Bishop. I don't remember so much from just watching the series and you know, just hearing about Cable and Bishop and you know, the rest of the X-Men. I don't really get so much light. So yeah, all I know is Marvel's dope. I love the X-Men, and there's so much goes on well, concerning that comic. That's why it pains me that you know, they haven't been doing so great with the X-Men movies as of late, because of the fact that you know, these companies like to do whatever they feel is necessary to get the big money, like how Disney is, the Disney and Marvel is. But the truth is that the basic truth is you can't replicate something that isn't your original idea. If anyone understands what I'm saying. But other than that, thank you guys so much for watching. If you guys enjoyed this, please make sure to like, comment, subscribe. Share this video, Facebook, Instagram, wherever you want to do it. Go to Comics Explained. Check out these videos. Make sure to subscribe to his content. He makes great content and stuff, and he explains things very well, and that's more than enough for me to understand. So thank you, Comics Explained, for doing that, for doing so. And as such, it's been The Real Sakurai, and I will see you guys next time.